Good afternoon and welcome to today's HAKOM webinar. My name is Stefan Komonik and I'm Managing Partner at HAKOM Time Series. Today I'd like to thank you all for the response and positive feedback that we're constantly getting for our webinars. Find us on social media. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on LinkedIn and Twitter for more articles and tech news following our principle that life is a time series. So, having said this, let's start today's topic, polyglot persistence storing big energy data.
So, hi out there from Madrid, Hagenberg and Vienna, and a warm welcome to the experts Martin from the University of Applied Sciences and Ricardo, founder of LeanXcale, and from the HAKOM side, our CTO Thomas and myself. So thanks a lot for joining us today. Let's start briefly introducing Martin. Martin is a professor of databases at the University of Applied Sciences in Upper Austria, and with a yearly 21 million euro budget of research funding and over 500 ongoing national and international projects makes the University of Applied Sciences the most research-intensive one in Austria. Martin works at the WinLab Research Group. This group focuses on multimedia web applications and discovers the analysis and presentation of media data in close cooperation with research groups in artificial intelligence and information systems and technology. Before Martin took over the professorship for databases, he gained many years of experience as a database developer at Oracle, and was involved in developing mission-critical applications for police, fire, and rescue operation centers. His current focus is on NoSQL and big data technologies. It's great to have you here today, Martin.
Hi.
Now, how about my namesake, Ricardo from LeanXcale? LeanXcale is a Spanish company focused on creating a database that provides data pipeline acceleration and real-time analytics at any scale. The LeanXcale database is a relational database blending the easiness of SQL and the performance of NoSQL. We will have a little bit more on that later. Amongst LeanXcale clients, we have big corporates such as leading credit scoring agencies and insurance companies. They use LeanXcale to speed up their processes by several orders of magnitudes. We think the LeanXcale makes a very good fit for energy companies due to its efficient data intaking, but also the capacity to deal with really large volumes in a very fast manner. What makes it very interesting for us is that they also have a very simple to use SQL interface and their linear horizontal scalability. Ricardo, their CEO and founder, has been a researcher for more than 20 years and became a worldwide expert on topics like distributed systems and relational database scalability until he left the academic career and created LeanXcale. Ricardo, it's super to have you here today.
Yeah.
But first of all, together with Thomas, I will go over why the energy sector needs excellent ways of persisting data. And as always, we should not forget that the lion's share of this data is time series. So let's go ahead. And the starting point is this view of the data processing challenge found in the energy sector, which we call the energy data jungle. But this is also similar across other verticals. We have many different data sources, storages, and at the bottom, you see various applications. Most of those applications depend on data coming in from many different sources, and some of them need to be processed in near real time. Now, this becomes particularly relevant when we consider the growing share of distributed sources of data. When we're talking about rooftop solar, distributed wind, or highly dynamic charging loads coming from e-mobility. In order to keep the grids balanced at the local, regional, and at the large scale, we need to not only keep track of data as it comes in, but must also execute actions which often depend on complex analytics. This can be aggregating figures or training machine learning models, using all the data available. But at the same time, we have to remember that this data is being used for clearing and for settlements, so it needs to be stored in a very particular way. And the concept for that is transaction consistency. Those of you with a finance background may know the classical example of transferring money between bank accounts. When you wire money from one account to the other and subtract in one and add it in the other, this has to take place in one go. Otherwise, if there is an interruption, you would have money disappear or be created. And the same applies to the energy generation and consumption data.
Yes, but now let's first look at how this got started. In the beginning, everyone had some sort of SQL database. So it had been easy to perform transactions for all important data. These databases have been of many vendors. First, we started with Oracle. Then later on, we supported Microsoft SQL Server. And afterwards, open source alternatives such as PostgreSQL started gaining traction. A middleware architecture was able to deal with the data in these different platforms by abstracting persistence from logic and processing the data in the business logic layer of the application. One example of this is the TSM data architecture you see here. With more ingest performance needed, storage performance and analytic query performance requirements increased. Traditional SQL databases could no longer keep up. Alternatives were in-memory databases, very good for high-performance queries, but not scalable, or NoSQL databases, very good for ingestion and distributed storage, as horizontally scalable, but with some complications in performing queries and the live data and problems in performing transactions. Back to you, Ricardo.
Thank you, Thomas. So we can combine those different elements, so in-memory and horizontally scalable, or even relational databases with more complex architectures. One example would be a Lambda architecture, which we will see some examples about later on. But let's just say that maintaining different data processing pipelines represents an added complexity and can still introduce bottlenecks. And if we want the best of all worlds for one and the same data, and yet we want to maintain our infrastructure as simple as possible, we have to look for alternatives. And what could those alternatives be? For that, I will invite Martin to give us an overview. Martin, the floor is yours.
Okay. Thanks for handing over to me. I will lead you from SQL to NoSQL and end up with NewSQL. We will focus on concepts that are necessary in the energy industry and for other IoT platforms. And therefore, we'll have a closer look at processing time series data and key performance indicators. If you try to get faster predictions, you face problems on two layers of your platform. The first is the ingestion layer, where data are collected and transformed to prepare them for storing. And the second is the persistency layer, where data must be processed at the same speed. If you speed up this whole process, you turn from batch processing to streaming data. That means that data have to be processed at nearby real time while they are produced. And for streaming data, processing times go down to milliseconds. Databases have different strengths depending on the use case they are designed for. Some can handle heavy writes and transactions, and others fit the needs for fast analytics, but can't provide immediate consistency for the data win. Therefore, many companies started to use different databases for different needs. And that led to a polyglot use of databases to run businesses as fast as required. That means, for example, the queries are forwarded to the database that fits best. And today we try to find out if there is a system that can handle all queries in a performant and consistent way. And consistency is in this case to be understood in the terms of ACID, explained by Ricardo later in this talk. First steps toward becoming polyglot were to separate transactional and analytical processing. And transactional processing is focused on small queries and concurrent writes, whereas analytical processing is focused on long-running analytical queries and batch-like ingestions. And they need not support ACID transactions if they are specialized in analytics. To get more computing power, you can add more RAM and CPU to one single machine. In this case, you must be able to afford expensive hardware. And to work around these problems, developers built new databases and new file systems that could scale out efficiently by connecting normal chip machines. So NoSQL was born. In general, systems scale out in different ways when you add more CPU and RAM to one machine, or when connecting more machines. What you try to get is linear scalability, but traditional SQL databases only scale out in a logarithmic way, but they can provide efficient queries and ACID transactions for structured data. One main reason that slows down writes is the widely used B-trees, but on the other hand, it enables efficient queries. Many NoSQL databases offer fast ingestion and horizontal scalability on write. Many of them use a flexible schema, many of them do not support transactions, and queries are often insufficient. And one component that speeds up writes in NoSQL is the use of sorted string tables. Data rows collected in memory are stored to disk in one single write. And on the other hand, that causes slow query because you have to search through all sorted string tables for a given fragment. To address these problems and reduce maintenance complexity, companies use a Lambda architecture. The batch layer addresses scaling write speed, but the drawback of this layer is that real-time analytics are not possible. To get accurate real-time results, The server layer is merged with a speed layer. The speed layer holds the most recent data not yet stored in the aggregates of the server layer. New SQL databases also try to address these problems of SQL and NoSQL, using new principles to build their databases. They provide an interface for NoSQL and the SQL view in one database to reduce complexity even more compared to a Lambda architecture. New SQL databases enable scaling and transactions as well as consistent reads and furthermore fast analytics and fast ingestion within one architecture for structured data like time series data or key performance indicators. And one concept they use to handle this log structured merge trees to optimize sorted string tables and B trees for read as well. So new SQL could be an alternative to a Lambda architecture. And now I'd like to hand over to Ricardo from LeanXcale for a detailed explanation of the CAP paradigm and what it has to do with scaling.
Hello, thank you. So the CAP theorem has become very famous because NoSQL vendors typically use it as an excuse of why not to provide as a consistency. So as we will see, the CAP theorem has no relationship to scalability. Let's go in detail. Let me provide a little bit of history. Eric Brewer, that who made the conjecture, he proposed a conjecture at the conference, distributed system theory conference called POTSI, and he challenged his colleagues. He was giving an invited talk because he studied with some of them, did a PhD with some of them, and then he said, well, I believe there is this relationship between consistency, availability, and partition tolerance. And then he made the conjecture. He didn't do a theorem. The theorem was actually done later by some researchers. So the things that the CAP theorem is talking about the replicated data. It's not talking about scalability or other properties. It's just telling that if we replicate data, we have to, and we want to tolerate partitions, we have to make a choice. Okay, and this is totally related to alpha transactions, as we will see. So what is the CAP theorem about? CAP is an acronym that comes from consistency, that is meaning that the application keeps some criterion about consistency of the data that can be very different. So you can define many different kinds of consistency. He didn't focus on a particular kind of consistency. He said that if you care about consistency of data, then you care about availability of data that he defined in a very particular way. And then you want to tolerate partitions, then you cannot do everything at the same time. So you had to choose one of the two properties. So then what are the asset properties that NoSQL vendors mess up with the CAP theorem? The asset properties are what are provided by transactional databases. It's atomicity, that basically there are failures. The effects of the transaction is all or nothing. Consistency, that is talking about the preservation integrity constraints. Isolation, that means that if we execute multiple transactions in parallel, it's like we execute them sequentially. And durability, that is once the database tells us this transaction has finished successfully, what is called committed, then you cannot lose any of the updates, even if there are failures. So what is telling the CAP theorem? So the CAP theorem, what it's telling is that if you replicate data, you want to keep the consistency across the different replicas. The different replicas should have the same value, let's say. Then availability means that anyone that is accessing any of the copies, any of the replicas of the data should be able to access the replica without any delay. And then partition tolerance means that you tolerate partitions. So what the CAP theorem is telling is that if you want to tolerate partitions, then you have to choose between availability and consistency. You cannot provide the three of them at the same time. So we will see then as an example. So CP means that you provide the partition tolerance and consistency. So this is what is called a primary partition approach in distributed systems. So basically, if you have a partition, then you will have a minority partition. The majority partition can progress, the minority partition will be blocked. So therefore, we don't provide the availability as defined in the CAP theorem. Still, data is available on the majority partition, and anyone that can access there will be able to work with the data. Then in the case of AP availability and partition tolerance, it means that we will have two partitions, but now both will progress independently. So we will fully lost the consistency of the replicated data because we have different copy of the same data item, and they, it will evolve totally independently. And with the partition skill, then you will have to make sense of the different values that you have from the different replicas. That is quite difficult. So that is why in practice, when you do a transactional database, you can only choose the CP. Okay. In general, when you want to make sense of your data, you have to choose the CP. So in summary, the CAT theorem is about the trade-off that you have in the choices to manage your replicated data. CAT theorem is totally related to scalability or ACID transaction. We don't have an S in the CAT theorem. And then ACID transaction can be scaled. And this has been demonstrated already by a few databases. The first two were Google Spanner and LeanXcale. So we demonstrated that we can actually scale up linearly transactional processing. So that is all what I wanted to tell about the CAT theorem. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Ricardo. I think this gives us a lot of food for thought that we can do analytics in real time with huge amounts of live or streaming data. And this should enable use cases such as the ones we brought up right at the start with grid stability, growing share of decentralized renewables and e-mobility, and maybe even others we haven't even thought of, like high frequency grid power quality, smart meter readings, real-time weather forecasts. So there's a lot coming up in the horizon. Awesome. Thomas?
Yeah, finally, another very important aspect to highlight is that being polyglot means we can move existing use cases to other persistence platforms, that is to other databases, without having to change the application-facing interface. That's what a time series middleware takes care of. So that said, it's now time for our call to action.
But before our Q&A session starts, if you're interested and would like to know more, you can schedule individual one-on-one meetings with us. On a short message, you will receive a link to select an appointment. But if you have a clear use case in mind, join us for a workshop at a very reasonable price. We will study the case and have a half-day workshop with you discussing how the new SQL platform of LeanXcale in conjunction with our time series service can be of use to you and your specific challenges. But for now, let's start answering the questions. So back to you, Stefan.
So now for our Q&A session, I will start with a question to Ricardo from LeanXcale. And it's asking, how would you position LeanXcale in comparison to technologies such as TimeScaleDB?
Well, TimeScaleDB is basically is something that has been put up on top of PostgreSQL. So the first observation is that PostgreSQL is a centralized database. It doesn't provide the scalability. You can only scale up by using a bigger machine. So the first difference would be that we can provide linear scalability with respect to TimeScaleDB and PostgreSQL. The second difference is in the ingestion speed, because LeanXcale is using the log merge trees that were explained by Martin before as a NearSQL database. We are able to ingest data much faster than PostgreSQL can do, that is based on B plus trees, despite this partitioning that is doing TimeScaleDB on top of PostgreSQL. That we also do something similar, but then when you go to the particular ingestion time on a particular partition, we are able to do faster because of using a different mechanism than relational databases. And the third one is about the aggregates that TimeScaleDB also provides. So it requires to have one thread, so you have many limitations, and the performance limited to the performance of this single thread. But in LeanXcale, we use one invention that we made, and we have a patent application on that are online aggregates. And with these online aggregates, we're able to compute aggregates and we ingest data. So whenever you have a KPI about the energy, for instance, total energy consumed per substation, you have it in real time. So then the things that you ingest the data, you will have this KPI already there. And then when you just query, it will be instantaneous because it will be just returning the value that is already computed. We respect any other approach that will have to traverse all the data for that substation and a period of time that will require a lot of resources. So you cannot do this query very frequently using other databases. While with LeanXcale, it doesn't consume. So you can even do the query every millisecond if you like. So you can have in real time the answer to that query without any relevant cost in infrastructure.
I think that answers it. I have a question that I think I can answer. If there's any benchmarks available for time series management with the different databases that we've shown, and whether there is a general rule when to use what. And I would say, yes, we have benchmarks with the different platforms and also with the different scaling of the middleware service in between. And depending on the machine that you have hosting the database behind, you can have numbers to the order of 100,000 or 500,000 inserts per second. You can scale this in different ways, and you can also have different aggregation performance figures, and you can optimize and tune the setup depending on what is your specific use case. So there are general rules when to use what. And I think one of the great advantages here of the approach LeanXcale is showing is that you can start with it even as you're small, with a relatively small number of instances, and then grow as your use case grows. But of course, there's then other concerns. What type of environment do you have? What type of infrastructure? This can all be discussed in more detail separately. The next question is whether is there a MongoDB connector available as well? Maybe that's something Thomas can
can answer this one. A very good question. We do not have a MongoDB connector ready to ship, but we do support the generic database interface. That's a very easy possibility to create new connectors. We also have sample implementations available for this. So it is very easy to create connector for any database and also for any other data source. Each customer can create a connector on themselves or ask us to create one for their data source. So if you need a MongoDB connector, we could provide one for you or give you sample implementations how you could do this on your own.
Thank you. Then I have a question. How about other data that is not in time series format, such as audio or video streams? Maybe Martin, you could comment on that.
Okay, this is not the same use case as an ingestion pipeline and a persistency layer, because when you store a video on a server, there are no ACID transactions necessary or things like that. So you have two use cases. The one is a live streaming, as we have here. There you will have to face latency, maybe between the audio and the video stream, because they come from two different clients. And the other is a streaming like Netflix does. There, the video is uploaded to Netflix and you start your stream on your own. And they use buffering to get rid of latency. And one thing is multicast in the backend for such live streams to reduce latency. And you use content distribution networks to get nearer to your clients and do not stream a Netflix video from the States, but instead from a destination in Europe. So it's mainly about streaming the data, not persisting them in this case.
Thank you. So I have another one. If we can please quantify ingestion and aggregation speed. I would try to answer, but then invite Martin and Ricardo to comment. Ingestion speed would be the number of rows that we're adding per unit time, per second or per minute. And aggregation is if we want to summarize, let's say, all the consumption from all the different smart meters, each one registered it in one row. And now we want to get the consumption of the entire city or the entire zip code. Then we want to aggregate all of them. And this would be the aggregation speed. So looking up on the table and summing it up. Would you agree with that definition?
Yeah, I agree with it. It's done in different ways in NoSQL and in SQL. That is the point of the talk today. Map reduce against group by on a very high level. In detail, it's more complicated.
Teufel steckt in detail. The complicated part is what lies below.
Maybe Ricardo likes to comment on highly incremental environments where the focus is on incrementing only one column with a counter. They are strong in this case. So maybe Ricardo wants to comment on this.
So the main thing about the aggregation is that you have two approaches. One approach is that you just store the base data, and whenever you want to do an aggregation, you have to traverse all the data. Okay, that is what all the relational databases do. And there are some approaches that are kind of ad hoc, or some databases support some of these, where you can try to build the aggregation in a non-linear manner. Like TimeScaleDB is able to do this, but it has limitations because it's doing it with a single thread, and the amount that it can do is limited to the power of this single thread. In the case of LeanXcale, we are based on something, an invention that we made that is called semantic multiversion concurrency control, that allows us to update data without any contention. And then we, because we are multi-versioning, then we can have multiple versions, but still each transaction we write will read the precise version. It has to read to have a full consistency. And with this, basically we remove all the contention, and we have a lot of concurrency, but then we get the benefit that the aggregation is computing real time. So when you read, you just simply read the aggregation. You don't have to traverse any data. Basically, that would be like these three approaches, where our approach is very innovative and has the best of all the worlds.
Thank you. In the interest of time, I see we are reaching our half an hour slot. I would just pick one more question, which I think is relevant that we emphasize here. One of our attendees is asking, is this database already available? And I think that's something Ricardo can answer with one very short answer.
Yes, it's available. It's available for on-premise, and it's available also in the cloud in Amazon. Regarding whether it's open source, it's proprietary, but we have a free version of the database that can be used for trials.
Thank you so much. So, what we typically do, we will wrap up the official session and stop the recording. But those of you that are interested, we would be available for another 10 minutes to continue answering some of the questions. I see there's a lot more open in the Q&A. So if you stay with us, then we can discuss them on the follow-up. So from my part and to all of you, thank you so much for your attendance. And once again, don't forget, life is a time series.